Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Twilight Zone, a novel by Nona Fernandez, translated by Natasha Wimmer, read by Raquel Beattie. I imagine and give voice to old trees, the cement under my feet, the stale air circling this place. I imagine and complete unfinished stories, reconstruct half-told tales. I imagine and bring to life the traces of gunfire. Entry Zone. I imagine him walking down a city street. A tall man, thin, black hair, bushy mustache. In his left hand is a folded magazine. He grips it tightly, seeming to draw strength from it as he walks. I imagine him in a hurry, smoking a cigarette, glancing nervously from side to side, making sure no one is following him. It's the month of August, specifically the morning of August 27th, 1984. I imagine him going into a building at Calle Huérfanos and Bandera, the editorial offices of Gausse magazine. I'm not imagining that part. I read it. The receptionist recognizes him. He's come before with the same request. He needs to talk to the reporter who wrote the article in the magazine he's carrying. I have a hard time imagining the woman at the reception desk. I can't form a clear picture of her, not even her expression as she eyes the nervous man before her, but I'm sure she's wary of him and his urgency. I imagine she tries to put him off, tells him the person he wants isn't here and won't be in all day. There's no point waiting. He should leave and not come back. And I also imagine, because that's my role in this story, a female voice interrupting the scene. A voice I can imagine as I write, if I close my eyes. "It's me you want," the voice says. "How can I help you?" The man studies the woman speaking to him. Probably he knows all about her. He must have seen a picture of her at some point. Maybe he tailed her once or read her file. She's the person he wants. The one who wrote the article he read and brought with him. He's sure of it. Which is why he approaches her and extends his right hand, offering her his armed forces ID card. I imagine the reporter wasn't expecting anything like this. She looks at the card in bewilderment, and fear, I might add. Andrés Antonio Valenzuela Morales, soldier first class, ID number 39432, District of La Ligua. Accompanying this information is a photograph stamped with the registration number 66650. I'm not imagining that part either. I'm reading it right here, in a statement later written by the same reporter. "I want to tell you about some things I've done," says the man, looking her in the eye, and I imagine his voice shaking slightly as he speaks these words, which aren't imagined. "I want to tell you about making people disappear." The first time I saw him was on the cover of a magazine. It was a copy of Gausse, the kind of thing I read back then, with no knowledge of the people featured in all those headlines, reporting attacks, kidnappings, strikes, crimes, scams, lawsuits, indictments, and other scandalous occurrences of the day. Accused bomber was local CNI boss. Degollados killers still doing time in La Moneda. The plot to assassinate Tucapel Jimenez. Did Dina order Calama executions? My reading of the world at 13 was shaped by stories and magazines I didn't own, that belonged to everybody, passed from hand to hand among my classmates. The pictures in each issue gradually arranged themselves into a confusing landscape that I never managed to map in its entirety, though each dark detail lingered in my dreams. I remember a scene I came up with in my head after reading some article. On the cover of the magazine was a drawing of a blindfolded man in a chair. An agent was interrogating him in the glare of a lamp. Inside the magazine was a catalog of torture methods. I read the testimonies of victims and saw diagrams and drawings that looked like something out of a book from the Middle Ages. I can't remember every detail, but clear in my mind is the story of a 16-year-old girl who said that in the detention center where she was kept, they had stripped her, smeared her body with excrement, and put her in a dark room full of rats. I didn't want to, but inevitably I imagined that dark room full of rats. I often dreamed of that place and woke up from the dream over and over. Even now I can't shake it, and maybe that's why I'm recording it here, as a way to let it go. In that same dream, or maybe another like it, I inherited the man I'm imagining. An ordinary man, no different from anyone else, nothing special about him, except for a bushy mustache, which I, at least, couldn't stop thinking about. His face was on the cover of one of those magazines, and over the picture was a headline in white letters: "I tortured people." Under that, another line: "Shocking eyewitness account by security services agent." In a pull-out section inside, there was a long exclusive interview. The man gave a full account of his time as an intelligence agent, from his service as a young conscript in the Air Force to the moment he went to the magazine to tell his story. There were pages and pages of details about what he had done. The names of agents, prisoners, informers, detention center addresses, burial sites, descriptions of torture methods, accounts of many missions. Powder blue pages, I remember them well, transporting me for a moment into some parallel reality, infinite and dark as the room I dreamed of. A disturbing universe that we sensed lay hidden somewhere out there, beyond the bounds of school and home, where everything obeyed a logic governed by captivity and rats. A horror story told by the ordinary person at its center, who looked like our science teacher, or so it seemed to us, with the same bushy mustache. The man who tortured people didn't mention any rats in the interview, but he could have been the tamer of them all. I guess that's what I imagined. A Pied Piper playing a tune that made it impossible not to follow him, not to march one by one into the disturbing place he inhabited. He didn't seem like a monster, or an evil giant, or some psychopath you had to run away from. He didn't even look like the national police in boots, helmet, and shield who charged at us with batons during street protests. The man who tortured people could have been anybody, even our teacher. The second time I saw him was 25 years later. I was working as a writer for a television series, and one of the main characters was based on him. It was a fictional series, with lots of romance, of course, which is a requirement on TV, plus plenty of persecution and death, in keeping with the subject matter and the period. The character we constructed was an intelligence agent who took part in detention and torture operations, and then went home and listened to a mixtape of love songs and read Spider-Man comics with his son at bedtime. For 12 episodes, we followed his double life up close. The absolute divide between the personal and the professional that was secretly crushing him. He wasn't comfortable in his job anymore. He was starting to lose his nerve. The tranquilizers had stopped working. He couldn't eat or sleep. He had stopped talking to his wife, stopped being affectionate with his son, stopped spending time with his friends. He felt sick, despairing, feared his superiors, was trapped in a reality he didn't know how to escape. At the climax of the series, he put himself in front of his own enemies, presenting them with the brutal testimony of what he'd done as an intelligence agent in a desperate gesture of catharsis and unburdening. To write the series, I had to confront the interview I'd last read as an adolescent. There he was again, on the cover. His bushy mustache, his dark eyes staring at me from the page, and that line printed over his photograph. I tortured people. The spell remained intact. His face loomed again, and like a rat, I was ready to follow wherever his testimony led. I pored over every word. 25 years later, my hazy map was gradually coming into focus. Now I had a clear sense of the identity and roles of the people whose names and nicknames he mentioned. Air Force Colonel Edgar Ceballos Jones, Air Force Intelligence Director General Enrique Ruiz Bunger, Communist Party Leader Jose Weibel Navarrete, Communist Party Member Kila Rodriguez Gallardo, known for his bravery, El Wali, Civilian Officer of the Joint Command, El Fanta, ex-Communist Party member turned informer and persecutor, El Fifo Palma, Carlos Contreras Maluje, Yuri Gaona, Carol Flores, Guillermo Brati, René Basoa, El Coño Molina, Mr. Velasco, El Patán, El Yerko, El Luti, La Firma, Beldewe, Remo Cero, Nido 18, Nido 20, Nido 22, the Juan Antonio Rios Intelligence Center. The list is endless. I re-entered that dark zone, but this time with a lamp that I had been fueling for years, which made it easier for me to find my way once I was inside. The lamp lit my path, and I became convinced that every bit of information delivered by the man who tortured people had been put out there not just to shock readers and open their eyes to the nightmare, but also to halt the machinery of evil. It was clear and concrete proof, a message from the other side of the looking glass, genuine and incontrovertible, demonstrating that the whole of that parallel and invisible universe was real, not some fantastic invention, as was often said. I last saw him a few weeks ago. I'd been working on the script for a documentary by some friends. It was about the Vicariate of Solidarity, an agency of the Catholic Church created in the midst of the dictatorship to assist victims. The film was a record of counterintelligence work carried out mostly by the agency's lawyers and social workers. From testimonies and material collected for each case of forcible disappearance, detention, abduction, torture, and any other abuses they handled, they were able to put together a kind of panorama of repression. By obsessively studying this landscape, the Vicariate team tried to expose the sinister logic at work in the hope of getting a step ahead of the agents and saving lives. We'd been working on the film for years, and the material was so intense it made us a little queasy. My friends, the creators of the documentary, recorded hours and hours of interviews. Each person described on camera how they joined the Vicariate, their work, and the strange way they gradually became detectives, spies, secret investigators. They all ended up analyzing information, asking questions, planning operations, building a mirror image of the enemy's security services, but to nobler ends. The interviews were utterly engrossing and thorough, making the editing process very difficult. Which is why I had to make sure to prepare for our meetings first thing in the morning, with a strong cup of coffee, so that I was as sharp as possible. I want to describe one such morning. Shower, coffee, notebook, pencil, and then pushing the play button to queue up new material to review. As I watched, I took notes, paused images, tested cuts in my head, listened over and over to clips in order to decide whether they were necessary or not. That's where I was, in the middle of testimonies, interviews, and stock images viewed millions of times, when he appeared, the man who tortured people. There he was, in front of me, no longer just a still image printed in a magazine. His face came to life on screen. The old spell was revived, and for the first time, he was in motion. His eyes blinked on camera. His eyebrows shifted a little. I could even see the slight rise and fall of his chest as he breathed. My friends explained to me that while he was briefly back in Chile, they had managed to secure an interview. He hadn't been back since he snuck out of the country after giving his testimony in the 80s. 30 years later, he had returned to appear in court and present further evidence, this time to a judge or multiple judges. It was his idea. He hadn't been summoned. Even the French Interior Ministry and the agents charged with his safety all these years had tried to dissuade him. What I saw on my screen that morning was the image of a man who had come home after a long time, hoping to bring a chapter to a close. In fact, he said as much in the only interview he gave to the press at the time. As I write now, I pull up the image on my screen again. It's him. There he is on the other side of the glass. The man who tortured people looks me in the face, as if it's really me he's talking to. He has the same bushy mustache, but it's no longer black. It's closer to gray, like his hair. 30 years have gone by since that photograph on the cover of Gausse magazine. 30 years, betrayed by the wrinkles furrowing his brow, his tinted glasses, the now gray hair. He's speaking in a voice I've not heard before. It's a calm voice, very different from what it must have been when he turned up to give testimony in 84. Soft and timid, even. Nothing like what I had imagined. It's as if he's answering my friend's questions despite himself, reluctantly, but with the conviction that it's his duty, as though he's following orders. I look at him and consider that. The secret compulsion to be constantly obeying some superior. Now it's all just part of an old story, and he keeps repeating the phrase, "I remember," as his eyes reveal the workings of memory. Only a few moments from the interview capture my attention. Things I haven't read elsewhere, spoken calmly, released into the air for me to gather and write down. I remember the first marches. People came out with posters of disappeared family members. Sometimes I walked past them. I saw those women, those men. I looked at the photographs they were carrying, and I said to myself, they don't realize that I know where that person is. I know what happened to him. My face is reflected in the television screen, and my face merges with his. I see myself behind him, or maybe in front of him. I look like a ghost in the picture, a shadow lurking, a spy watching him, though he doesn't know it, which is partly what I am now, as I sit here observing him, I think. A spy watching him, though he doesn't know it. He's so close, I could whisper in his ear, pass on some message he would mistake for a thought of his own, because he doesn't see me, doesn't know I'm here, intent on speaking to him, or writing to him, actually, which is the only thing I know how to do. It could be a couple of sentences on the screen that he'll read like a ghostly apparition before his eyes, a sign from beyond the grave, which is something he must be used to. A message in a glass bottle, tossed into the Black Sea, where all those who ever lived in that dark parallel zone are shipwrecked. It won't be easy, but I'll get his address and write him a letter in an attempt to make contact. The letter will be perfectly formal, using phrases like, "Dear Sir, I am writing to you. Sincerely yours." Because that's the only way I imagine he'd ever read it. In it, I'll tell him I want to write about him, and I think it's only right to let him know. And maybe, if he's interested, make him part of a project I have in mind. Dear Andres, we don't know each other, and I hope my boldness in tracking down your address and taking the liberty to write won't stop you from reading this letter. The reason I want to be in touch is that I have dreamed of writing a book about you. Why? Good question. And indeed, I've wondered as much myself without finding a satisfactory answer. I can't explain it exactly, because the source of my obsessions is never clear. And over time, that's what you've become for me, an obsession. Without realizing it, I've been following you since I was 13 years old, when I saw you on that Gausse magazine cover. I didn't understand everything that was happening around me when I was a girl. I still don't. And I suppose that, in my attempt to understand back then, I was captivated by your words, by the possibility of using them to decipher the enigma. Later, for work, and because I was interested, I came to know your story in greater detail, and I read everything about it that I could get my hands on, which still seems paltry and insufficient given the value of the information you provided. Now, writing to you, I'm trying again to clarify my motives so that I sound less vague, but the honest truth is that all I can come up with are more questions. Why should I write about you? Why should I resurrect a story that began more than 40 years ago? Why bring up curved knives, electric shock torture, and the rats again? Why bring up the disappearances? Why should I talk about a man who was part of it all, and at some point decided he couldn't be anymore? How do you decide when you've had enough? What kind of line do you cross? Is there such a line? Is the line the same for all of us? What would I have done if, like you, I had reported for military service at 18 and my superior had sent me to guard a group of political prisoners? Would I have done my job? Would I have run away? Would I have understood that this was the beginning of the end? What would my partner have done? What would my father have done? What would my son do in the same place? Does someone have to take that place? Whose images are these in my head? Whose screams? Did I read about them in the testimony you gave the reporter? Or did I hear them myself somewhere? Are they part of a scene from your life or mine? Is there some fine line that separates collective dreams? Is there a place where you and I both dream of a dark room full of rats? Do these images creep into your mind too, and keep you awake? Will we ever escape this dream? Will we ever emerge and give the world the bad news about what we were capable of doing? When I was a girl, I was told that if I misbehaved, the man with the sack would come for me. All disobedient children disappeared into that wicked old man's bottomless dark sack. But rather than frighten me, the story piqued my curiosity. I secretly wanted to meet the man, open his sack, climb into it, see the disappeared children, and get to the heart of the terrible mystery. I imagined it many times. I gave him a face, a suit, a pair of shoes. When I did, he became more disturbing, because normally the face I gave him belonged to someone I knew. My father, my uncle, the corner grocer, the mechanic next door, my science teacher. Any of them could be the old man with the sack. Even I could probably play the part if I looked in the mirror and drew on a mustache. Dear Andres, I'm the woman who wants to look into the sack. Dear Andres, I'm the woman who's ready to draw on a mustache to play you. If you've read this far, and my request doesn't seem absurd or inappropriate, I'd be grateful if you'd write to me at this address. I eagerly await your response. The alarm goes off at 6:30 every morning. What follows is a long chain of hurried, awkward acts, an attempt to start the day by shooing away sleep, to forge ahead while yawning and wanting to go back to bed. Drawers opening, cups filling with coffee and milk, taps turning, showers, toothbrushes, deodorant, combs, toast, butter, the morning news, the announcer reporting the latest carjacking or the day's gridlock, heating lunch for my son, putting it in a thermos, making a snack for recess. And between each rushed activity, calls of, "Hurry up, it's late, let's go." The cat meows. It wants food and water. The garbage truck goes by, taking away the trash we put out last night. The school bus stops in front and honks for my neighbors. The children come out yelling. Their mother sees them off. The man with the dog goes by with his dog and waves as I'm opening the gate, and my son's father is starting the car, getting ready to leave. The young man who jogs is jogging. The woman with the cell phone is talking on her cell phone. Everything is just like yesterday, or the day before yesterday, or tomorrow. And in the spatio-temporal cycle that we move in daily, my son gives me a kiss to complete the ritual, gets in the car with his father, and the two leave at exactly 7:30 so as not to break the protective spell. It's been like this for years. We began the routine when my son was little. In those days, we didn't have a car, and each morning I said goodbye to him as he walked out the door to nursery school, holding his father's hand. I kissed him and hugged him tight, because secretly, I was panicked that I might never see him again. Terrifying thoughts assailed me each time we parted. I imagined a bus barreling into him, a live wire dropping from electric poles onto his head, a mad dog coming out of a house and lunging for his neck, some pervert picking him up from nursery school, the man with the sack kidnapping him and never bringing him back. The possibilities were dramatic and infinite. My fearful new mother's brain fabricated horrors, and in that unhinged exercise, each time he came home was a gift. With time, the madness came to an end. I no longer dream up calamities, but during that morning departure ritual, I always focus on the image of my son and his father as they're leaving. It's a snapshot suspended in my mind until I see them again. An uncontrollable impulse that I inherited from those days as a frightened new mother. The distillation of an archaic fear that I suppose we all have and try to keep under control. The fear of unexpectedly losing the people we love. I don't know what the morning routine must have been like at the Weibel Barahona household in 1976. I was just 4 years old, and I can't even remember what my own mornings were like back then. But with a little imagination, I can see that house in La Florida and the family beginning their day. I doubt their routine was much different from the one I follow daily with my family. or the one that all families with children in this country have been following daily for years. I imagine the Waybell's clock marking the launch time, maybe 6:30, the same as ours here. I imagine Jose and Maria Teresa, the parents, jumping out of bed and delegating the morning tasks. One makes breakfast, the other gets the children out of bed. One helps them get dressed, the other ushers them into the bathroom. One heats up the lunches, the other prepares the snacks. One is in charge of calling, "Hurry up, it's late, let's go." A perfect, well-oiled machine, probably better oiled than ours, because there were two children in the Waybell Barahona household in 1976, not one like in ours. So their morning maneuvers must sometimes have acquired heroic proportions. On March 29, 1976, at 7:30 a.m., the same time my son and his father leave the house each day, Jose and Maria Teresa left to take their children to school. They waited at the bus stop nearby with one of their neighbors, who, in my mind's eye, has the face of the man who walks his dog each morning in my neighborhood. In all likelihood, they greeted each other, as they probably did each morning, just as the man with the dog and I nod at each other when he passes by each day, the two of us planting the flag of everyday normality, tracing the fine line of our protective routine. At 7:40, as part of their own daily ritual, the Waybell Barahonas got on a bus on the Circunvalación Américo Vespucio line, which would take them to their destination. The bus was probably full. I can't know that with certainty, but I assume it was, because at that time of day, buses all across the country are full, no matter the decade. Maria Teresa sat in the front seat with one of her children in her lap. Maybe Jose sat next to her, holding their other child. Or maybe he didn't. Maybe he remained standing, moving as close to his family as possible so as not to be separated from them. Not to break the threads that keep them safe within rescue distance. Jose and Maria Teresa don't talk about it in front of the children. But this apparently normal morning isn't exactly that. Jose's brother disappeared a few months ago, and he himself, a high-ranking member of the Communist Party, knows he is being watched. Yesterday, a young man they didn't recognize rang the doorbell to ask about a washing machine that was supposedly for sale. Jose and Maria Teresa know the significance of this strange and disturbing visit, so they've decided to leave their beloved house on Calle Teniente Merino in La Florida this very day. The children don't know it, but they're about to be dropped off at school, and at the end of the day, home may be somewhere else. I imagine Jose and Maria Teresa ride in silence. They are both tense and probably don't feel like talking. I imagine they answer their children's questions, stay engaged in the conversation. But inside, they're wondering what the future holds for them. They're probably watching the faces of the people around them. Surreptitiously, they look out for suspicious glances, threatening gestures. They're on the alert, but it's hard to keep track of everything going on. There are lots of people on the bus at this hour, lots of people getting on and paying the fare, lots of people walking past and sitting down and falling asleep, lots of people standing, lots of people looking out the window. So even though they do their best, they don't spot him in the crowd. Even when their gazes meet, they don't see him. It's him, the man who tortured people. Armed Forces Intelligence Agent Andres Antonio Valenzuela Morales, registration number 66650, Soldier First Class, ID number 39432, of the District of La Ligua. Tall, thin, black-haired, with a dark, bushy mustache. He sits at the back of the bus, He wears a hidden radio transmitter to communicate with the vehicles following them unseen. Nearby is El Huaso, with El Alex a few seats away, then El Rodrigo. Each agent has gotten on separately, mingling with the passengers, and now they're watching the Waybel Barahonas unnoticed. But maybe they are noticed. Maybe José lets his gaze linger for a moment on the dark eyes of the man who tortured people. Maybe he sees something troubling in those eyes, something he doesn't have time to process, because just then, a woman screams, startling everyone. "Somebody stole my purse," she says, and as she speaks, three cars cut off the bus. Then things happen very quickly. Six men get on through the back and front doors. El Alex and El Huaso shout that it's José who snatched the purse. "That's the bastard," they say, and they point at José, who barely understands what's happening, though he's beginning to have an idea. The Waybel Barahona children look at their father in bewilderment. He's been with them all this time, near, very near, never breaking the threads that keep the family within rescue distance. So he can't have taken anyone's purse. And anyway, he's their father, the man who gets them out of bed every morning, who takes care of them, who brings them to school. He's no thief. But it doesn't matter what the children think, because the man who tortured people and his companions approach José, point a gun at him, and say they're police, and he's under arrest for robbery. It doesn't matter that José has no allegedly stolen purse, or that Maria Teresa is crying and pleading for help, because she knows exactly what's happening. It doesn't matter that the children are scared, that the bus driver doesn't understand what's going on, that the passengers are watching in fear. The man who tortured people and his companions shove José out the door, and in less than a minute, they've put him in one of their cars, and he's gone forever. I wonder whether José took a mental snapshot of his family in that instant. I wonder whether he managed to catch a last glimpse of his wife and children from the car, freezing the protective image. My runaway sentimental imagination wants to believe that he did, and that the image helped him keep terror at bay in the gray realm where he was condemned to spend the last days of his life. In the privacy of the Gausse magazine offices, the reporter listened to that story. It was one of the first related to her by the man who tortured people. I can imagine the moment perfectly. He, sitting in an office chair, still nervous, ill at ease. She, listening from behind the desk with a tape recorder running. The words of the man who tortured people are being recorded on tape that is turning and turning in the machine. As the reporter's imagination begins to run away with her, as mine does, staging the scenes that emerge from his testimony. José riding in the car with a group of unidentified agents. The bus with his family in it, fading into the distance behind them, getting smaller and smaller until it disappears, severing the threads that keep the family within rescue distance. The reporter can finish the rest of the story herself, because she knew José. They were close friends, and she's heard Maria Teresa describe the same scene on the bus from her own perspective. Now, in 1984, 8 years later, neither Maria Teresa nor the children nor the reporter know what's happened to José. Envoy from the dark side. Guide to that secret dimension. The man who tortured people said José was taken to a command center on Calle 18, called La Firma. The man who tortured people said José was taken straight to an interrogation cell. The man who tortured people said José's interrogation was one of the harshest of the era. The man who tortured people said that, even so, they failed to discover that Jose was the Communist Party's second in command. The man who tortured people said that, later, Jose was taken to the house.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.